pirates are beyond a stereotype at this point. There's such a consensus as to what a pirate looks like in the public's mind that it would seem a doomed proposition to try to give audiences something a little different and hope for success. Yet, that happened with the least likely property. The Pirates of the Caribbean films are obviously tied to the enormously popular Disneyland ride, but they do a great job of establishing their own world and characters, some of which are so beloved that they worked themselves back into the ride itself a few years after the first film came out. It seemed like the whole world was quickly swept up into pirate fever, and so was I. The first film became a household favorite for long car rides, and the soundtrack was often played. However, by the release of the third film, the world seemed to have moved on from the series. I suppose that's because it was so bombastic and had a sense of finality to it that, while people thought the series might indeed continue, most had already checked out by that point. The fourth one made $1 billion at the box office, but I can't exactly say it had staying power with audiences or was received all that much better than the previous sequels. By the time the fifth one appeared, the world seemed to collectively sigh at the prospect of another adventure. Yet many people my age still consider the first film to be more than a cult classic. A lot like The Princess Bride or the 1999 version of The Mummy, it's not hard to find diehard fans these days. I've enjoyed the series in my own way, and I guess the inspiration for this video was partly because I've been spending a lot of time playing Sea of Thieves with my nephews, and there are some missions based on this franchise in that game. The format for this video is going to be a lot more like my Indiana Jones review, in that it's less of a ranking and more of a retrospective of each of the films in succession. The reason why is because a ranking of this series for me would just look like a chronological listing of the films. I like the first one the best, and I think they get progressively worse with each installment. But given the impact this series had on pop culture while I was going through high school, I think it's important to explore why that was, and why so many others failed to capture that same success. So, let's start at the very beginning, which is a very good place to start. Pirates of the Caribbean: The Curse of the Black Pearl was released in the summer of 2003. Being the first major film released with the Disney logo in front to be PG-13, none of us seemed to know why we should care about it. The trailers hadn't really done a good job of communicating what kind of a film this was going to be, and The Country Bears had just come out the year before and seemed to cement the idea that films based on Disneyland attractions was a bad idea. Yet, this film had actually been in the works for over a decade. During the early 90s, Ted Elliott and Terry Rossio were working on an idea for a supernatural pirate film, but no studio was really interested at the time. Separately, Disney had begun work in 2001 on an adaptation inspired by the ride. The early drafts were more straightforward pirate films, and featured several elements and characters that would survive into the finished version. But it wasn't until Elliott and Rossio suggested a more supernatural-focused plot that the script started to come together. If you've clicked on this video, you're probably already familiar with the story of this one, but just in case you aren't. A band of pirates led by Captain Jack Sparrow discover rumors of a treasure chest said to be filled with cursed Aztec gold. Before they can reach the island, there is a mutiny, and Hector Barbosa replaces Jack as the captain. Upon arriving on the island and not believing the stories, the crew steals the gold and spend it all. They seemingly kill a member of the crew for opposing Jack's mutiny named Bootstrap Bill Turner. Before he is thrown overboard, Bootstrap sends one of the medallions out to his child. Only afterwards do they realize the curse is real, and they need to put all the gold back along with some blood from each offender. Since Bootstrap Bill is presumed dead at this point, the crew has to find all the gold, along with the child they knew Bootstrap had prior to the theft. The kid in question is Will Turner, who is working as a blacksmith in Port Royal, with the final medallion being in the possession of his childhood friend, Elizabeth Swan, who Will is in love with. During an attack on Port Royal, Barbosa's crew kidnap Elizabeth, assuming her to be Bootstrap's child. Will saves Jack Sparrow from a prison on the island, and they set sail to rescue the damsel in distress. If you know this film, you know that the summary I just gave was a horribly condensed version, and that's because there's a lot going on in this film. Each main character has their own motivations that play huge parts in the story, and I didn't even talk much about Jack Sparrow, who has a lot more to do with this plot than my summary might suggest. The reason I bring this up is because I think that's the film's greatest strength. The story is surprisingly easy to follow, despite it being a very complicated story once you figure all the backstory into it. You're never confused as to who wants what, why, and where their allegiance lies. With the exception of Jack, who is a deliberate wild card in this plot. I think the subsequent films took the wrong lessons from this first outing. They seem to want to fill themselves with more complications in order to copy this first film's success without truly understanding why the film was able to keep such a tight focus despite the many story layers. The casting of this film was also a dire ingredient to get right. John Huston once said, "Half of directing is casting the right actors," and even the film's writers acknowledged that this is what happened. Jeffrey Rush quickly became one of the franchise's staples, and that's because he gets the role of Barbossa as written for every movie. In the first outing, he's meant to just be a straight bad guy, without too many complications. Rush was cast specifically because the director, Gore Verbinski, knew that he wouldn't try to infuse the character with extra layers just to satiate his actor's ego, and I appreciate that. Rush is a delight in every film, and he progressively gets more of those layers with each of the subsequent outings, and yet he never totally loses that original sense of fun with the character. Orlando Bloom and Keira Knightley were rising stars at the time. I keep forgetting how early in their careers this film came out. Bloom plays his role fine, and he's probably the weak link in the main cast here, but not in a detrimental way. Will Turner is an earnest young man who grows into being more of a real person by the end. He's meant to be the straight man in this world of craziness and piracy. It's only in the following films that I think major missteps are made with this character. Keira makes more of an impression on me. She plays the mirror to Will Turner here. Elizabeth is a fairly straight-laced girl who longs to follow her heart. I love that she actively tries to escape her situation once she's kidnapped. This very easily could have been a passive character, but Keira sells us on the active nature and risk-taking. We've now seen what a powerhouse actress she is, but this is one of the stepping stones I think she needed to do before we could get to things like Pride and Prejudice, Atonement, and The Imitation Game. But let's be honest, the main talking point in the cast here is Johnny Depp. The writer says that he performed the role just as they wrote, but that it came out nothing like they expected. Looking at pirates as the historical precedent to the modern-day rock and roll stars was an inspired idea, and Captain Jack Sparrow quickly became the face of the franchise. There is a big issue I have with this character, but it's not really applicable to this film, so I'll discuss it a bit later on. Let me say for now that, just based on this performance, he was rightly nominated for an Oscar, and it's one of the more original characters we've seen from big genre films in a while. The other side players are all populated with great character actors. Kevin McNally, Jack Davenport, Jonathan Pryce, Lee Ehrenberg, Mackenzie Crook, Zoe Saldana, and even the unnamed characters are all fun to watch. This is the kind of casting that only happens once in a blue moon, and man do I appreciate their contributions. Production design is also incredible for this film. While all the pirate films are aesthetically pleasing on a design level to me, this one really stands out, in that almost every location is memorable and are the kinds of sets that I would love to tour. The action here is pretty solid, my favorite bit being the battle between the Black Pearl and the Interceptor, especially the lead up to it. It's a kind of quintessential pirate scene in films for me. Probably the most notable thing in this film are the sword fights. This film had Bob Anderson for a coordinator, and they couldn't have gotten a better man for the job. An Olympic fencer, Bob had worked in films for almost 50 years prior to this, and his work can be seen in Star Wars, The Princess Bride, The Mask of Zorro, Dine of the Day, and the original Lord of the Rings trilogy. He was also a stuntman in From Rush with Love, The Guns of Navarone, Superman 2, and had even earned the nickname of The Man Who Stabbed Errol Flynn, when he slashed Flynn's thigh on the Master of Ballantrae. The fights are incredible, mostly for having a unique style of fighting for each character that perfectly fits their personality. I can't possibly talk about this film without also talking about the soundtrack. It honestly sounds to me like leftover stock material from Hans Zimmer's earlier efforts from The Rock and Crimson Tide, and yet I can't help but love it. It's a driving, heavy, engaging soundtrack that has plenty of old-fashioned romantic elements to it. Zimmer composed the few themes that are in this film in about a day, and gave the principal scoring duties to one of his underlings, Klaus Badelt, as he was too busy scoring The Last Samurai. The simplicity of the themes are evident upon a single listen. There's very little counterpoint to make the themes more complicated. I think this is a score you could capture all of the important moments with the similar energy on a two-handed piano. That's not a criticism, though, as this score has been one of the most popular in the last 25 years. Originally, Alan Silvestri was hired to compose the score, and while I do love the current soundtrack, I'm dying to know what his offering would have sounded like. Silvestri can do the big and bombastic music as well, as evidenced by Back to the Future and the Avengers films, and he can also do more tender romantic themes, like you hear in his offerings for Forrest Gump. So I'm wondering what the issues were between him and producer Jerry Bruckheimer. This film is not perfect, though. I always thought the hanging at Port Royal was an action beat too many. Some of the specifics of the backstory, as told by Gibbs and later fleshed out by Pintel, are a little hard to piece together upon first viewing. And I also felt the storm bit in the middle came out of nowhere, and ultimately serves little purpose, except to address why the compass doesn't point north. Despite these issues, Pirates of the Caribbean: The Curse of the Black Pearl was more fun than it had any right to be. With a good sense of adventure and romance, a quirky sense of humor, and well-defined characters with great performances, it made over $600 million worldwide at the box office, and dominated home video sales. Everyone was completely taken aback by the film's success, and Disney knew they had a potential goldmine on their hands. Wanting to capitalize on their success, Disney greenlit two sequels to be shot simultaneously and released a year apart. The hype for 2006's Dead Man's Chest was insane. Everyone wanted to see what the follow-up to Curse of the Black Pearl would do, and the trailers were promising. All the principal actors were back, and we were ready for the same fun and adventure as we had last time, and that's exactly what we got. Kind of. I want to make it clear that I don't hate this film at all. I think it has a lot of strong things going for it, but it is a step down for several reasons and ultimately sets the course that the rest of the franchise would follow with diminishing enthusiasm every time. This film has Jack trying to save his own skin from a deal he previously made with Davy Jones, the ghostly ruler of the Flying Dutchman. He thinks that by acquiring something called the Dead Man's Chest, he will have some leverage against Jones that will allow him to strike another deal. At the same time, Will and Elizabeth are arrested for rescuing Jack from his hanging in the last film. Will is given a chance to escape the noose himself by acting as an agent for the East India Trading Company on behalf of Lord Cutler Beckett. He is to go retrieve Jack's mysterious compass and bring it back. Yet Jack isn't willing to part with the compass until he finishes his own quest, so Will agrees to go along for the ride. So this film's basic plot feels like it's a little easier to explain than the first one, and yet many have criticized Dead Man's Chest for feeling overbloated. I think that's because all of the extra things I left out of the summary aren't tied into the direct goals of the main two stories well enough, and they add unnecessary layers to a film that's already pretty grand in scale. Plus, while there are a couple of good, colorful new characters that I enjoy spending some time with, almost everyone from the last film are treated as major supporting characters that hog a bit too much of screen time for their own scenes. Plus, there's a fair amount of repetition going on here. I don't just mean scenes and lines from the first film, although there's quite a bit here, but in exposition of the film's initial premise. It wasn't until the Nostalgia Critic pointed it out in his review that I finally figured out why it felt as though the film took so long to get going. The first 45 minutes or so honestly feels a bit like an extended prologue. It sets up the characters, the tone, and even does a decent job at seeding what the film's main plot is going to be, but it takes too long to accomplish these goals before we get to the actual meat of the story. In addition, I think it's too coincidental that Jack is just now stumbling on the key to the chest at the same time as Beckett arrives in Port Royal to kick off his own search. I get that Jack has encountered a number of things that may have prevented him from going off in search for it before now, but what's Beckett's excuse? He's not the head of the company, he seems to have a fair amount of autonomy and plenty of loyal soldiers, so why is he only now coming into Port Royal to begin his search? So I mentioned earlier that I had a big problem with Jack Sparrow in this series, and I saved it for this part because it doesn't start to become relevant until the sequels. I think he's overused, and the films constantly place the emphasis on the wrong syllables with him. They tend to over-exaggerate the weird mannerisms and catchphrases, without really capturing the real reasons why Jack worked so well in the first film's story. Yeah, he had the weird walk and the catchphrases there too, but he was, for the most part, played as a charming, quirky scoundrel. His plans initially seem stupid, and his mannerisms are a little off-putting, but you realize later that he's the smartest person in the room, and he's a lot more sane than you might have initially believed. He never unfairly dominated the scenes he was in, and there was a good sprinkling of him during the film's runtime. From here on out, Jack's front and center, played for laughs in almost every scene, the antics are heightened to ridiculous degrees, and his quirks are overdone. I think Disney may have thought that it was the catchphrases and the mannerisms people reacted to, and they didn't seem to understand the deeper layers of the character and why people really connected with him. By the last two films, Jack loses almost everything that made him interesting and starts to become insufferable. It weirdly becomes like watching someone do an SNL parody of the character. A shame, really, given how popular he was at the start. I'm not saying that shifting leads entirely from Will and Elizabeth to Jack couldn't have worked. The Pink Panther series started as a vehicle for David Niven's character, but upon release, the studio quickly realized that it was Peter Sellers' character that everyone was talking about. So instead of making a similar kind of film to the original when they came around to do the sequel, they shifted the tone to work with Clouseau as the lead, and the series became known for its comedy. I think the shift to Jack as the central character could have worked if they had done one of two things. One, keep Jack the mostly straight, charming, and roguish scoundrel with some intelligence and quirkiness, but keep the same tone as the original. Or they could have gotten rid of the more down-to-earth elements and characters and made it a broader comedy by focusing on the oddness of Jack. This film feels like it sort of wants to do the latter, but by adding the more down-to-earth characters of Will and Elizabeth as major parts of the story, you've messed up the balance. For my money, the best new addition to the cast is Davy Jones. Yes, the CGI still really holds up today, but it's Bill Nighy's performance that's the standout. He feels like an entirely different kind of villain from Barbossa, with his own style of humor that feels right at home with a Pirates film. The tragic love story is given a lot of weight and helps to add to the spectacle of the legend. He has another cursed crew, though they are very different from the last one, and they have such unique designs that I want to pause the film and look at each one of them in turn. This is probably a good time to transition and talking about music. Hans Zimmer takes over primary scoring duties for this outing, and this is an example of everything that he does best in action films. It's not quite my favorite in the series, but it's got a number of really good things. The Kraken piece is loud and heavy, Jack's new theme is quirky, sly, and fun, building off of an idea from the previous score. There are plenty of reprisals of earlier themes, and there are fun curveballs thrown into the music occasionally, like the waltz that's played over the Bone Cage escape. The best piece of new music is Davy Jones' theme. By using both the music box and the organ, we set up the bookends of the haunting spectrum of emotion that is that character, and throughout this and the next film, there are a number of occasions where this theme comes back and goes everywhere in between music box and organ. Right alongside He's a Pirate, this is the theme that comes to mind when I think of this franchise. That tune has stayed with me from the first time I saw this film. The action is a bit more cartoony than the previous film, but there are some really solid moments here. The bone cage escape, the action on the spinning wheel, and the giant kraken battle at the end are my highlights of those, but some of the action scenes do go on a bit too long for me. The final twist with Jack's death was pretty shocking to me at the time, but the film quickly reassures the audience that he'll be back for the next one and has a solid stinger to leave us with, the return of Captain Barbossa, which quickly turns the frowns upside down. That one moment was one of the biggest talking points after the film came out, and I think that's a testament to how much Jeffrey Rush connected with the audience from the first film. Dead Man's Chest retains a lot of the fun from the first film, but in trying to deepen the experience and expand the universe, it begins to muddy the waters a bit and suggests that it wouldn't be smooth sailing going forward. Yet audiences were clearly still on board for a sequel, and thankfully we wouldn't have to wait that long. At World's End would come the following year, and there are two things I remember in the lead up to this film's release that seemed to me very unique. The first was that there was only one theatrical trailer released for the film, which only came out about 2 or 3 months before the release. Given that several major pictures from Hollywood at the time had 2 or 3 trailers, I remember being a little disappointed by that. Also, this is the first major film that I can recall that started to do Thursday afternoon showings before the Friday premiere. My mom was particularly excited about that because it meant that she could get to bed at a decent time for work the next day. This film continues from where Dead Man's Chest left off. Barbossa, Will, and Elizabeth are off to retrieve Jack Sparrow from Davy Jones's locker. Apparently, the alliance between Jones and the East India Trading Company has prompted several pirate lords to come together to form a Brethren Court, where they can meet and figure out how to respond to this threat. Jack is one of the 9 pirate lords and failed to nominate a successor before he died, so he needs to be brought back. All of the character conflicts from the previous film are here, as well as introducing a few new complications. As much as I have a soft spot for this film, I'm not blind to its many, many problems. The introduction of the Brethren Court and retroactively making that the reason for going to rescue Jack feels like a completely out of left field story choice. At the end of the last film, it was because they missed him. Now it's because he's a pirate lord and is required to be at the court. They even have a scene in the film where Jack asks if anyone came to save him just because they missed him, and most of the main characters say nothing. The addition of this retcon feels a bit like the writers came back to write the film years after finishing the second one and thought this would make some things interesting, except we know that they wrote these films at the same time. So my question is, why wasn't this development mentioned or hinted at in the previous film? This makes the films feel a little less cohesive to me because the writers are just adding retcons every time. It happened between Dead Man's Chest and the first film, where Bootstrap Bill is suddenly alive and Davy Jones is now real. It happens between Dead Man's Chest and At World's End, and by the way, it will continue to happen throughout the rest of the series. I know some people have commented that the opening scene is a really jarring one, but I've never minded it. The film wants to be a little bit more serious and carry a bit more weight, and I think that's a brilliant move if the rest of the film had followed through on that tone. As it plays now, it's a scene that I mildly watch and then almost completely forget afterwards because we quickly move on to scenes with sailing a ship over the edge of the world, multiple Jack Sparrows, and Chow Yun-Fat's colorful performance. I think the sequence in Singapore would have been a much better opening to the film because it showcases the tone much better. It's kind of all over the place, but I'm usually in for that kind of schlocky ride, and had this been my first impression, I would have been completely on board. Besides, Jeffrey Rush and Chow Yun-Fat are chewing up the scenery together, and I love watching that. I have mixed feelings about using Tia Dalma in this adventure. Given that she transforms into Calypso, which seemed pretty obvious to me given all the hints that were strung around her cottage, it makes sense that Barbossa would insist on bringing her, but for the majority of the film, she doesn't contribute to the adventure or interact with the main characters that much, so she feels pretty pointless. Naomi Harris is an actress I really like, but she seems to be a little lost in this film. She plays most of her scenes pretty seriously, with only a hint of the sly smile and fun that she brought to the last film. It's not a bad performance, but the character is one I forget is even in the film until her Calypso transformation later on. The second act of this film is where it slows down and drags for me. It introduces a lot of the double-crossing that so many have criticized this film for. It's not impossible to follow, really, but it does screw with our perceptions on who we're supposed to root for, which leads to me not caring as much. I also think Jack's entrance in the film goes on a bit too long, though it is pretty memorable. I could also do without the inane Pintel and Rigetti bits. Now, I do like the reunion with Jonathan Pryce. That scene contains some of the best acting in the entire series. How they get out of the locker is pretty inventive, and leads to one of my favorite uses of the World's End theme. I also need to give an extra shout out to Depp and Rush during this act. Their bits of comedy work a lot better for me than the Pintel and Rigetti bits, and their conversation over the body of the Kraken contains some of my favorite lines in the entire series. The Brother in Court is full of some really colorful characters, and this is where the film kicks back into high gear in terms of energy for me. Yeah, I wish they played a bit more of a part in the finale, as making the whole battle between the Pearl and the Dutchman feels a little underwhelming. The actual climax is a riveting bit of action, with lots of humor and cool sword fighting. My big criticism is that the rain obscures the visuals enough so that it can be hard to tell what's going on at any one particular moment, if you're not constantly paying attention. The death and quick resurrection of Will is where the film really starts to lose me, mostly because it feels unnecessary and there's a number of things that I would love to have cleared up. I could maybe be led to buy it if the idea was that we needed some losses to remind us of how important this battle is. But the film quickly backtracks on it and brings him back, so it loses the impact almost immediately. I feel like I need to address the curse with Will and the Dutchman. This may seem like a bit of a nitpick, but this is one of my biggest problems with the film and prevents me from fully embracing it. The rules of the curse are pretty unclear to me. As I understood the story with the curse, the reason why Davy Jones becomes a tentacle monster is because after the breakup with Calypso, he neglected his duties to ferry souls to the afterlife, and so that's why he turned into a monster. So Will is now bound to the Dutchman as a new captain. By the end credits scene, I think we're led to believe that he faithfully fulfilled his duties and that after 10 years, he's free to be with Elizabeth and his son. Yet by the beginning of the fifth film, he started to become cursed as well. So did he neglect his duties too? If he was always going to be bound to the Dutchman, what's the point of the end credits scene? Was Will mistaken when he told Jack earlier that the curse was inflicted upon anyone who didn't do the job? If that's the case, then why even have those lines? Plus, he only gets one day on land every 10 years for eternity? I love Kira, and I'm sure that day is epic every time, but I doubt anyone could make a single day worth 10 years at sea. Finally, I can't not talk about the music here. This is my favorite of all the pirate scores. It's got great uses of all the principal themes from the other films and adds several new and great musical moments of its own. Much like the original film, there is a main theme that serves as both a romantic theme and an epic adventure overture. I absolutely adore this tune and think it's one of Zimmer's best contributions. Hoist the Colors is also a fine song, and helps to add a great taste to the musical palette. At World's End is a misguided film that dawdles a bit too much. A nearly 3-hour finale for this series is pushing it, but even though a lot happens here, it ultimately feels like little was achieved in the grand scheme of things. When I was a teenager, this was my favorite of the sequels. But the more I watch it, the more I feel the weight of the film buckling under the many problems it has. I'm still entertained by it, but I come away with mixed feelings at the end. I really think the series should have just ended here and left well enough alone. But they didn't. Not willing to let things go, and after the last two films brought in about $2 billion combined, Disney wanted to try their luck yet again. On Stranger Tides was released in the summer of 2011, and despite it making $1 billion on its own, most people shrugged and quickly forgot about it. Now, on the surface, the film looks like it's correcting a lot of the issues from the last two films. It streamlines the plot, gets rid of Will and Elizabeth, brings back only a handful of characters from the other films, has a simple MacGuffin that everyone is after, and has a much shorter runtime. However, it all goes downhill pretty fast. Captain Jack Sparrow is after the Fountain of Youth this time, continuing a minor idea from the previous films about wanting to live forever. He finds that a former girlfriend named Angelica is impersonating him to recruit people for her own expedition for the fountain in London. Turns out, she's working for Blackbeard, who somehow survived his real-world demise. Blackbeard is seeking the fountain to save himself from a prophecy that predicts his death at the hands of a one-legged pirate. Along the way, this group has to contend with mermaids, the Spanish Armada, and even a returning Barbossa who has become a privateer for England. So this doesn't sound all that bad, right? Well, my problem is that the film continues to make similar mistakes to the last two entries. It puts Jack front and center again and continues to emphasize his cartoony antics, so once again the film misses the point of the character. While the film thankfully doesn't have Will and Elizabeth this time, it does try to have its cake and eat it too, by adding a missionary that gets into a romance with one of the mermaids, which feels about as studio mandated as you can get. It also adds a number of twists and turns to the film's plot that doesn't really ramp up the tension, but instead convolutes what's supposed to be a simple story. Here's some of the questions I have regarding minor details that I get hung up on. What's the point of the zombie crew members? Why can Blackbeard's sword control his ship? Why does kissing a mermaid mean you're protected from drowning? And why does Scrum mention that during that conversation? Why does Blackbeard have a voodoo doll of Jack? Also, speaking of Blackbeard, this is a pretty minor nitpick, but how does he have Queen Anne's revenge again? In real life, before his death at Ockcrow Inlet, he ran it aground and transferred his crew to a smaller ship, which was the one he was captaining when he was killed. So how and why does he get it back? Now that's not to say that there's nothing fun and worthwhile here. The shining lights in the cast are Angelica, Blackbeard, and Barbossa. Penelope Cruz seems to have a clear understanding of her character's role in the story, and her scenes bantering with Jack is where I'm enjoying his character the most. However, my major issue with Angelica is that I'm not really sure I understand her longing for a father. I get that she hasn't had one, and desires some sort of relationship with her biological father. But given how he treats people, including her throughout the film, why is she so determined for this dysfunctional relationship? Especially with a guy who's thought to be irredeemable. Did I miss something here? Ian McShane is perfect casting for Blackbeard, and his first few scenes are great. But the character ultimately feels a little undercooked and tamer than I would like, especially for being the pirate that all pirates fear. He doesn't come off as vicious or nefarious, he comes off as mean, which feels a couple of steps down from where he should be. Coming after two great villains in Barbossa and Davy Jones, Blackbeard can't help but seem a little underwhelming. Barbossa is now an entirely different character to what he was in the original film, but Jeffrey Rush is having such a ball playing him that I don't really mind. The mermaids seem to be the most memorable thing from this film. Hans Zimmer goes particularly hard on the mysterious elements in the score, adding a solo female vocalist with their melody, and the idea of making the mermaids particularly vicious like the sirens of old is great and leads to a really awesome action scene. Although for years, I could swear that that first mermaid is Amanda Seyfried. Speaking of the score, Zimmer returns for primary composing duties here. He doesn't add too many new themes, but it's a perfectly serviceable effort. The main thing I do love is bringing in guitar duo Rodrigo y Gabriela. They are criminally underused in the film, but they do have a couple of good standalone pieces on the soundtrack album in case you're curious. As I've mentioned before, the so-called romance is so forced and rushed that I get absolutely no enjoyment from watching it. Serena just makes puppy dog eyes at Philip the whole time, and he's struck by her beauty and thinks she can't possibly be an evil creature, despite the earlier action scene proving the opposite. It just seems like he loses all sense of thought and reason about her because she's pretty, and claims that she wouldn't have killed him, quote, because he's different, which I have no idea as to what that's supposed to mean. If the film isn't really going to do that much legwork to make me interested in these characters, then the time we spend on them feels wasted, and I don't appreciate a movie taking lots of time focusing on those kinds of characters. Especially when it's in a film that has several elements that are working for me. The opening action scene in London does nothing for me. It feels so routine, and it does very little interesting or unique looking. The fountain itself looks pretty boring in its design once we get to it. Jack's deception with the chalices was obvious to me from the first moment that I saw it in the theaters, and I'm so confused as to why the film plays it like a reveal. On Stranger Tides is a paint-by-numbers affair. In trying to correct the mistakes of the past, it takes one step forward and moves two steps backwards. In a lot of ways, it strikes me as an even more watered-down version of the first film. I get mild enjoyment here at various scenes and characters, but I'm mostly bored. For a while, this was my least favorite of the series, and my wife swears she remembers me being ruthless on this film the first time we rewatched it. I may have been at one point, but I've softened my tune a bit. Despite my criticisms, I think the film is just okay, but it is definitely in danger of going too far overboard and souring people entirely on the series, and for many at the time, it seemed to do just that. By the release of Dead Men Tell No Tales in the summer of 2017, I had long since buried Pirates as a franchise and had moved on, so it was a surprise to me that they actually managed to put together a fifth one 6 years after the previous entry. As much as I may have been critical of aspects from the previous three films, this one was by far the biggest letdown. If you followed me for a little while now, you know that I try to rein in the criticism a bit. I don't think anyone should take perceived failures in films too seriously or so personally. However, that doesn't mean you have to like or sit through anything that you aren't enjoying. There have only ever been three times that I have ever wanted to walk out on a film in the theater. This was one of those times. The film so badly mishandles the things I may have liked about it, and feels like it emphasizes everything I felt was wrong about the previous films. There are a couple of things I do like, and I'll get into those, but this is an experience I'll never forget. This isn't a contender for the worst film I've ever seen, not by a long shot, but it's certainly a contender for one of the worst theater experiences I've ever had. Jack Sparrow is stuck in a rut. He isn't making any money as a pirate, and his crew has abandoned him. In his desperation, he sells his trademark compass off for a bottle of rum, which unfortunately unleashes an old undead pirate hunter who blames Jack for his curse. At the same time, Will and Elizabeth's son, Henry Turner, is looking for Jack to take him to something called the Trident of Poseidon, a relic that contains the powers of the sea and might be able to break his father's curse. He rescues Jack and a woman named Karina, who is also looking for the Trident. They set off with Jack's former crew, while dodging the pirate hunter named Salazar all the while. So let's get the things I liked out of the way first. First up, Karina. Kaia Scodelario does a fine job with the character, and I was more interested in her story than Henry Turner's. I like her personality and a lot of the acting choices she makes. I think she has natural comedic timing, and she's a welcome presence in the film. The character doesn't ultimately work for me by the end of the film, but I appreciate what Kaia brings to the film. The score is done by Jeff Zanelli, who was a ghost composer on the previous films. He adds his own flair to the music while still keeping it squarely in the same realm that Badlit and Zimmer had put together. The scene that I like most is where Jack is about to be beheaded with the guillotine. The film suddenly seems to wake up and remember where it comes from. It has a lot of the same zany energy as something from like Dead Man's Chest. Nice work there, folks. There's also a few bits of humor here and there that I think are pretty funny. They're few and far between, but they do exist. Now that that's out of the way, let's move on to the criticisms. Jack is a pale shadow of what he once was. His plot here reminds me too much of Austin Powers losing his mojo from The Spy Who Shagged Me, and that just doesn't fit with these style of films for me. Regardless of whether or not it actually makes sense, he's no longer fun to watch, and I just want him to shut up and sober up. Barbossa is also not as fun as he was before. Rush does what he can with the character, but it's just a step down from the previous films. I generally dislike revealing surprise children in sequels to big blockbuster films. There are a few times where that works, like in Logan, but I disliked it in Kingdom of the Crystal Skull. I disliked it in The Rise of Skywalker. I disliked it in Superman Returns. And I really dislike it here. The reveal feels like it's just there to give Barbossa a reason to be in the story, and that's a dangerous place to be in with a beloved character. It also has some unintended consequences on certain scenes from the previous films now. When you go back to Curse of the Black Pearl and watch Barbossa's introduction with Elizabeth during the parlay and a couple of moments where he's lusting after Elizabeth, I'm now stuck remembering that their children get together, which make those scenes a lot less fun to watch now. Salazar is played by Javier Bardem, who, like Ian McShane in the last film, is a brilliant choice to bring into the series. But man, he's so unmemorable. His very first line is, "Duh," which is one of the most unoriginal opening lines I have ever heard from a villain. He has a number of things in common with past villains of the series too. He can't go on land, just like Davy Jones. He has a past history with Jack, just like Barbossa, Jones, and Beckett. He has another cursed crew that are between life and death, and there's so little unique about his own personality that makes him stand out from the rest of the villains. The one bit that I like with him is the sword tapping scene with Barbossa. I love Bardem as an actor in most everything I've seen him in, but this is my least favorite role he's done so far. Henry Turner is played by Brenton Thwaites, who brings a similar sincerity to his role that Kaya does, and he is a big improvement over Sam Claflin's Philip from the last film. But after the first few scenes, he gets very little to do, and I often forget he's even in the film. Once we get past the execution scene, he basically spends the rest of the time captured in one way or another, and doesn't help progress the film in any meaningful way until he is possessed by Salazar towards the end. He just feels like an extra person in many scenes for most of the film. Several sequences just drive me up the wall. The heist early on with the horses pulling the bank is too much for me. Not only is it copying a similar idea from a sequence from Fast Five, a film I can weirdly take more seriously than this one, but none of it is that interesting to me visually or comedically. It's the most inane and cartoonish scene in the series for me, and that's saying something. In a franchise where you have undead skeletal pirates battling a British Navy, a three-way sword fight within a water wheel, a battle with fish people in a maelstrom, and an attack by vicious mermaids, somehow Jack Sparrow running on top of a roof as it collapses behind him in slow motion is where I check out. The wedding on the island feels like a deliberate waste of time, and isn't at all funny to me. The bit with the zombie sharks is also dull. They don't really look that intimidating, I'm never afraid for the characters' lives, and I just have a hard time taking any of it seriously within the reality the film has sold me. Another nail in the coffin for me is all of the continuity errors. These are things I rarely indulge in, and the series has made plenty of blunders before now, but I'm kind of astonished how many of these baffled me on my most recent viewing. Feel free to skip to the end if this stuff bores you, but if you have an answer for any of these, by all means, take me to school in the comments. First, Tia Dalma says back in Dead Man's Chest that Jack bartered the compass from her. Here, Jack gets the compass from the dead captain before him on the Wicked Wench. Second, Salazar is freed only once Jack gives the compass away, or as the film calls it, betrays the compass. Hasn't Jack given the compass to several people in the past? He gave it to Elizabeth in Dead Man's Chest, he gave it to Will in At World's End, and he gave it to Gibbs in On Stranger Tides. How is this giving away constitute a betrayal? Thirdly, Jack's hat. He has it on when he is on the anchor towards the end of the film and the water closes in on him. However, he never goes to recover it by the end. That's bizarre to me given that the earlier films demonstrated he has such a great love for that hat. So why doesn't he at least try to go get it or get a replacement for it? Fourthly, Scrum is a part of Barbossa's crew at the end of the last film. How or why is he here with Jack, when he is a far less successful pirate than Barbossa, who has a whole fleet of ships? He didn't seem particularly loyal to Jack during Stranger Tides, so why is he here? Finally, I have many questions about just the final scenes and the post-credit scene. Let's touch on the post-credit scenes first. It certainly presents a major error. If all the curses of the sea are broken by breaking the trident, how does that equate to Davy Jones being resurrected and returning in his monster form? Also, Will is only alive because his heart was cut out. Did breaking the curse mean his heart simply returned to him undamaged? To repeat the point from At World's End, why is Will cursed with sea life on his face? I thought you were only supposed to be cursed if you didn't do the job, so did Will neglect his duties? These last few questions regarding the ending aren't so much continuity errors as much as they are just things I would love to know. First, as much as I love that Elizabeth shows up at the end, isn't it out of character for her not to join her son on an adventure to rescue Will from his curse? She's probably only in her early 40s at this time, so she's not too old to join the trip. And as far as we know, she only has the one child, so the film doesn't present any real reason for her not to join Henry on this quest. This very easily could have been fixed with Henry addressing this in the scene with Jack at the prison. Second, Will seems to give up on his family in the prologue, and that makes little sense to me. Now, I've never been cursed to sail the seas forever between the realms of life and death, but Will seemed to be at some sort of peace with that fate in At World's End. And in that film's post-credits scene, we see him perfectly fine without sea life on his face and happy to meet them. Given that the prologue scene for this film is only about 2 or 3 years after that, why is Will not interested in the chance of being reunited with his wife and son again? Did I miss something? Finally, and this is an insanely minor point, but I can't help but wonder where Bootstrap Bill is in all of this. He'd be alive too at this point, so why isn't he there at the end as well? I get that Skarsgård might not have been available for filming, but given that the crew flew out to England just to get Kira in the film, which, as I understand it, was due to negative test audiences' reactions of her originally not being there at the end, why couldn't you have thrown Bill a bone and let him be reunited with the only family he has left? So much of Dead Men Tell No Tales feels like it's on autopilot for me. It's got none of the magic from the original films, and it feels beyond tired. I weirdly had a similar reaction to a much smaller degree with X-Men Dark Phoenix. It comes out way too late for anyone to be that interested in it, and it's made with some fundamental misunderstandings of what made previous stories work. It was already past time for the Pirates franchise to either have a dramatic overhaul in the form of a reboot or to be laid to rest, and this film just opened up some old wounds for me. Given the rumblings I've heard about the possibilities of a Pirate 6, and having heard some of the ideas that they have thrown around, I really wish we would let certain franchises just pass on. This is one of the longest videos I've written, and I feel like it could have been even a lot longer. The Pirates of the Caribbean franchise found a really great sweet spot that so many other films couldn't, and then proceeded to get every last drop out of it that it could. Pirates are a staple of old Hollywood, and there are plenty of memorable films featuring them. Captain Blood, The Seahawk, Peter Pan, and Treasure Island were all household favorites at some point. I appreciate Gore Verbinski and crew updating that genre for a more modern audience, while clearly having respect for those older tales. The first film seemed to be a minor inspiration on cinema for a while afterwards, and Johnny Depp suddenly became an A-lister overnight. The series eventually got watered down and lost sight of the tight balance that made that first outing work. I do have a soft spot for several of these entries, and I think they deserve to be discussed when talking about the state of modern Hollywood, even if they're not the most critically beloved of any series.